Blog Talk Radio.
When you're born in this world, you're given a ticket to the freak show. And when you're born in America, you're given a front row seat.
And the daylight was heavy with thunder, with the smell of the rain on the...
I'll tell you what I think. The cocksucking elite who own and run everything in this fucking country are selling it out from under us tomorrow.
Forget the politicians. The politicians are put there to give you the idea that you have freedom of choice. You don't. You have no choice. You have owners. They own you.
Here comes that rainbow again.
There's dick jokes coming up. Please relax.
They got you by the balls.
Let's do this.
Indeed. Hello. Hello and welcome, my fellow freaks, to the front row at the Freak Show. I am your host, as always, Steve Crafts. All right, my fellow freaks. So, here we are. It is September 8th, and I guess a lot of things kind of going on here at the front row. We did end up taking last week off from the show, and hopefully you caught that message on blogtalkradio.com/front row. You know, we put up there, obviously, that it was Labor Day, so we decided to observe the holiday and take the day off from the show. Hey, you know, kind of bullshit, to be honest. And I'll tell you what, you know, I was actually kind of hemming and hawing about, you know, whether or not I talk about this on this show here, but then I said, because, well, damn it, I'm paying for this, so I get to say what the hell I want, but actually, front row at the Freak Show is well, potentially moving, I guess. Already haven't been, obviously, here on Blog Talk Radio all that long, about a month, 5-6 weeks maybe, and but we have potentially found a new home on w4cy.com, and that's an internet radio station. What we're going to do is this. For the next, we haven't made a commitment to the fellas over at W4CY Radio yet. We're going to kind of do a month, little trial period, and see how it goes. And during that time, I'm going to try, of course, to do this show as well. Keep this going until I am fully sure about making the switch. And but if all goes well, at least right now, not enough room in the Craftsman schedule to be doing two separate podcasts. So we would probably separate at that point from BTR and just head over there. But you know, honestly, I don't know which way it's going to go yet. I think real good different things over at W4CY, and I think it's a lot of the things that we ultimately want to do, but it's also the bigger commitment and on a lot of levels, so anyway, we just don't know, but so that's, you know, kind of the big doings around here at the front row. Let's see, a few other matters of business before we get going here. So anyway, you can listen to us on W4CY.com Fridays noontime. And the one thing I do like about it, I guess, first, here at BTR, which I have no complaints about, let me mind you. when I have that slot noontime on Fridays, I am the only live spot on that, you know, on that station at that time, as opposed to here at BTR when, you know, everyone's kind of live when they want. So, hey, is the live thing ultimately a huge deal? I don't know, but we have had our pre-show ritual here. We did get in our chicken wings, our pint of vodka, and our two hits of double-barrel chocolate mescaline, so we are, in fact, all fired up for tonight. The other places you can find the Front Row, frontrowatthefreakshow.com. We are slowly chipping away at trying to get that to be the site that we want it to be, and we are now tweeting fairly regularly, and you can find us on Twitter, follow us on Twitter, at The Freak Show. Yeah, I know, it's ridiculous, but you know, all Twitters are at the at sign, and then we're at The Freak Show, after the at sign. Of course, Front Row is gone, Freak Show is gone, In the Front Row, on the front, all that shit was gone, you know, so we had to go at The Freak Show. And then, of course, Front Row at The Freak Show on Facebook and YouTube. You can also find us. So anyway, the other little, thing about this W4CY radio thing is that what I'm kind of doing, and obviously, like I said, I don't have, you know, the time to do two podcasts a week right now. I don't. That's what I want to be doing, but until this becomes my full-time job, shit, it's hard enough doing the one. But, so anyway, I hope you'll excuse me a little bit, you know, flying a little bit by the seat of my pants here, where, you know, the past, for the past episodes been, you know, kind of fully, you know, scripted, all that, had everything drawn up. But this is more of now, at least for the next month, going to be the, you know, kind of the warm-up show for the one on Friday. And one of the, I haven't figured out if it's a pro or a con yet, but the Friday show is only 50 minutes. So where my episodes on this platform here have been snuggling up close to 2 hours, if not hitting it, and running out of time. I have to keep it to 50 minutes every Friday. So, but just with that stuff and the material, like for tonight and probably the next couple of weeks, it's still kind of the work in progress until I hit it Friday. So, hey, that shit is what it is, all right? So, anyway, what I would love, absolutely love at any point in time this evening, if you are out there listening live here to the Front Row at the Freak Show, give us a call. We're still looking to break the ice with that first caller, you know? And I know you're out there, wherever you are. But the number to do that is 646-668-8756. So, you know, don't be shy. Give a call into the Front Row. Let's see if we can get some dialogue going. I'm going to tell you right now that tonight's show, a couple weeks ago, we left off talking about waking up and the waking up process. And I had started getting into and covered, you know, good freaks to know and people to start, you know, expanding your horizons on as far as listening to and tuning into as you tune out of the Mockingbird mainstream media. And then I was going to get into the actual big club, you know, and the players involved there and the systems and the corporations and the well, a little bit of the infrastructure, I guess, of the big club and the history and whatnot. But this week, obviously, bit of a special week here. It is the 13th anniversary on Thursday of September 11th, 2001. And as I think you've figured out here in the front row, 9/11 is, well, pretty big deal to us. To us here, and you know, well, I guess we'll just leave it at that. I guess we really see 9/11 as a springboard, I guess, for lack of a better term, but we feel that, or I feel that if a majority of Americans, citizens of the world, what have you, if enough of us freaks can wake up to the truth of 9/11, then we can start really generating some real change around here. Because if we're not afraid to take this on, then everything else, in my opinion, will somewhat take care of itself. Because waking up to the truth of 9/11 is really, as I tried to point out and make the connection of 9/11 and the Federal Reserve and the connection between the big club, the powers that be, again, I've said it before, people hear inside job and they think that, you know, Bush and the senators and the, you know, congressmen sat around and talked about how to fly planes into buildings. No, but it's the criminal elements inside the government and outside that allowed 9/11 to happen and unfold the way it did. And so, as you all know, so anyway, what I was ultimately kind of getting at was that as opposed to picking up about the big club and all that stuff, I decided to take this whole show, the entire show, I think with the exception of the tune I'm going to play, but take this whole show, and it's going to be all about 9/11. Okay? So, as you know, I like to start off each week with the front row scuttlebutt, and I was thinking, as opposed to, you know, kind of talking about some current headlines and news and stuff that's happening, I was wondering what headlines I would have liked to have seen, say, on September 12th of 2001. Or in the days and weeks that followed. You know, what are some of the headlines that, instead of the ones that we actually saw, what are some of the ones that I would have liked to have seen, right? So, and I wrote a few down here. So, so here's your kind of 9/11 front row scuttlebutt edition. Number one, first headline that I would have liked to have seen, say this one definitely would have been, you know, September 12th, the morning of September 12th, when you wake up and get your newspaper. America attacked. Osama bin Laden fingered before investigation. As I got into a little in the 9/11 and the Fed episode, Osama bin Laden, folks, was blamed within minutes, almost, of the towers being hit by planes. I mean, certainly within a day, Osama bin Laden had been clearly pointed to as the culprit, although he never, ever claimed credit for it, unless, of course, you want to count this supposed video that was released of him in, I think it was December of that year, but there was some video that got leaked of Osama bin Laden just being a chattermouth and talking all about the attacks, right, inside of one of his caves. And, you know, the thing is just an absolute insult. The guy, supposedly he was on Osama bin Laden, looks nothing like him. I mean, he's like 50 pounds heavier. The nose is 10 pounds heavier. The guy's like wearing a ring on his finger, and that just, it's completely disgusting as far as actual credible footage. But also, if you don't remember, the Taliban actually offered, within weeks of the 9/11 attacks, they offered to serve up Osama bin Laden on a platter if the United States would deliver the proof that he did it. And they never did, and so they never did. So that's, you know, true story. Second headline that we would have liked to have seen soon after 9/11, 2001. Two planes, three towers. Culprits must have also used explosives. Yeah, I mean, almost as bad as pinning it on Osama bin Laden immediately was the immediate dismissal of all the reporting and the witnesses of what the hell actually happened the day before 9/11. I mean, almost every single TV reporter, both in studio and live in New York, were talking about the multiple explosions being heard live on air and told to reporters by witnesses on the scene. And then, of course, just the obviousness of Building 7 had Dan Rather, Jennings, you know, all the big guys. They just all sat there, and you can look it up on YouTube. And in one way or another, they all said something to the effect of, you know, you've seen that this looks just like when there's a controlled demolition of a building. It looks very similar to that. Yeah, you think? And, again, this was just never picked up on after September 11th. You know, after that, it was nothing about the multiple, the second and third and fourth and fifth explosions. All the firefighters reporting about the multiple explosions. I mean, we have the testimony of hundreds of firefighters talking about multiple explosions that went on that day. But, nope, it was on to Osama bin Laden, war in Afghanistan, and fires brought the towers down. And if you say otherwise, you are an unpatriotic shitbag. All right. Headline three that I would have liked to have seen after 9/11. What hit the Pentagon? Oh, that would have been a great headline. CNN's Jamie McIntyre, live, and again, you can YouTube this, it's out there for all of everyone to see. This is what he said, quote, live that day reporting on CNN. From my close-up inspection, there's no evidence of a plane having crashed anywhere near the Pentagon. He went on a couple of pieces. I'm paraphrasing. I'm not paraphrasing, but I'm cutting to the next piece. The only pieces left that you can see are small enough that you can pick up in your hand. No large sections. No wings. No tail. Nothing that you would that would indicate a plane struck the building. You know, it's actually been a little while since I had looked at it and what Jamie went on to say about what he said that day. But, of course, you know, He later went on to, like, deny that he said this or that he was taken out of context and blah, blah, blah. I mean, it was ridiculous, you know. Obviously, Jamie had some heat put on him, but, I mean, you just look at the video, the live feed of exactly what he said, and it is pretty obvious what he is saying. And then when you look at the actual footage from that day and the pictures of the Pentagon after a supposed 757 went into the building, and remember, folks, that the roof, right, it didn't collapse for like an hour and a half after it was hit. Before that, and there's clear pictures of this, clear as day, the hole that's in the Pentagon is literally 15 feet wide. 15 feet wide. And they're saying that a Boeing 757 fit in, you know, wingspan of 130 feet, fit into this 15-foot hole. And you say, well, okay, just the body went in. You know, oh, great, okay. Well, then two big-ass wings should have been left right on the lawn. Right? No wings. Nope, just a 15-foot hole. No wings on the outside. No, you know, the engines, which are mounted on the wings. Right? Even on the sides of those 15-foot holes, the windows aren't even broken. So it wasn't even like something smacked on the side of them. No, no, no. So you have this 15-foot hole. There's no debris anywhere. And then check this out, right? So the plane, supposedly, you know, the Pentagon, it's got the rings, right? It's got the 5, the A, the B, the C, the D, the E. And I probably should have checked out my numbers right before I got on, but the plane went through like three of the rings, okay, and punched a hole in the outer wall of that third ring. However, there was no debris left, so the plane was strong enough to punch the hole in the ring, yet it then vaporized into nothing. I mean, what they want to get you to accept, my fellow freaks, is beyond insane. It's absolutely ludicrous when you really just start and take a step back and look at what they are trying to get you to accept here as truth. And I'm not going to, you know, I did the episode on it for now. I'm not going to get into the flight path that Hani Hanjour supposedly took to get into the Pentagon in the first place. The fact that there's no marks on the lawn anywhere before the whole... I'm not going to do it right now. Okay. Actually, headline four would have been two planes vaporized. Two planes completely vaporized when you think about the Pentagon and the one that went down to Shanksville, Pennsylvania. Oh, hold on. We got a call coming in. Let's see if we can take it. We got a call coming into the front row. Let's go to caller in 978 area code. Let's try to do this. It says hit a live button.
Stevie,
hello,
Johnny
you are
Freedom.
On the Johnny Freedom. Johnny, how you doing tonight?
Enjoying the show, Steve. I thought you were going to take aim at none other than Noam Chomsky tonight, so I was kind of anxiously anticipating you getting around to Chomsky.
Well, you know, Johnny, you did have a little bit of an inside word on that, and I appreciate you bringing it up. And we are going to take on Noam. I was doing my headline segment first. On the headlines, I would have liked. What do you think, Johnny, any headlines that you would have liked to have seen soon after 9/11?
Well,
not to
you
put
know,
you on the spot there, big dog, but
no, it's quite all right. At the time, I was okay with the headlines that I saw because, you know, it was a very shocking and emotional time mm-hmm. for the country and myself, who happened to be on the road
sure.
at the time, away from my home
sure.
and wondering how I was going to get back as all the airplanes
yeah, you were
grounded.
Weren't you? Unlike the Bin Laden family that got to fly around and leave the country for the few days after 9/11, but, you know, we'll leave that alone
yep.
for now.
I had a drive back to Massachusetts from St. Louis when I had anticipated flying, but with the grounding, we had to make that executive decision and leave early. But I digress. So it is a very tumultuous and emotional time. But, you know, it's interesting that you're talking about, you know, rewriting history. And I will certainly listen to when you get in the Chomsky. You know, I saw the headline on the blog, your front page, so I thought it would be great. You know, Chomsky had a pretty significant impact on the college-age me back in the late 80s. His book,
mm-hmm.
Manufacturing Consent, which I've probably
sure.
heard, you might have even heard me over the years talk about that book. Well, you know, it took aim at the Reagan-Bush 1 presidencies and their penchant
mm-hmm.
for manipulating the media and spinning
mm-hmm.
Stories and, you know, deceiving the public and sort of writing their own version of history in order to drum up sentiment, whether to go to war or attack or to whatever agenda they wanted to put in the public's mind. Well, that was what
mm-hmm.
was carried out by the lapdogs in the media. So it was very powerful at the time because, you know, as a teenager, you know, you always kind of think, hey, this is America. This is, you know, we're land of the free, home of the brave. We're straight up. You know, we don't do that kind of thing. That kind of stuff is what they do in Russia. Well, you know, it was an eye-opener. But what's interesting, and maybe you can touch on this when you get there,
mm-hmm.
is what, you know, Reagan and Bush were supposedly doing, I think, has been mastered by the left. So there's a level of manipulation going on today that would make those guys blush. I don't know if you agree with that, but I think that they saw the model
yeah.
and have run with it to the point where...
No, it's a fantastic... Well, you got, I think, a couple of points in there, Freedom, that I think are worth mentioning. And you know, first of all, Noam, and that's, you know, it's funny because the thing I take on with Chomsky tonight is that Noam, you know, has never, let me back up a second. You're absolutely right with as far as the impact Noam has had on, you know, young minds and you know, generations at this point.
Sure.
I mean, the guy's written over 100 books, obviously, and
a hero of the left,
you know, might be considered one of the greater intellectuals of our time, if not the, you know, intellectual
sure.
of the, you know, latter half of our century, but of the 20th century, but that's one thing that you know it. It stuck in my craw when I first heard it 5 years ago, and then today, all of a sudden, I was going through different 9/11 videos, and I saw the Chomsky thing, and his take on it has just always been weird for me, you know? And his kind of, you know, like you take like a manufacturing consent, right? And the things he puts out there, and not just out there in that, but, you know, in all his articles, whatever, on the media and the control and everything. And he thinks, and you know, obviously you'll hear what I have to say in a little bit coming up, but, you know, the idea of the Bush administration or anyone within it is absurd and insane, you know? And so it's really weird that he, you know, just absolutely puts the kibosh on it, you know? And again, I really listened to... He's got a few interviews out there on it, and I think during the time, especially like the few years after it happened, obviously he was a go-to guy that a lot of people would ask about it, right? And I think he got kind of sick of it, answering it, and you never know with the big club, you know what I'm saying? You know, the pressures that they put on guys to be able to say certain things and not certain things, and you know, it's like okay, no,
for his own life.
Exactly, or his family's, or whatever. You just never know. You know, Noam, we let you go this far, but, you know, you're someone that we want laying off this. But the other thing I wanted to just pick out about what you were saying is when you say that the left has now mastered it. Okay? And
yep.
The only thing I would say is don't get caught up in that left-right paradigm. You know, because,
it's all the same guys, same players.
Exactly.
It was like your choice in 8 or 12 years ago when your choice was John Kerry and George Bush, and they were both frat brothers back in the Skull and Bone Society at Yale within 2 years of each other. I mean, these guys were boys, and that was your choice.
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
Same guy. Just one represented,
you know,
one side.
Two arms of the same monster, whatever, however you want to, you kind of want to put it. And it's the one big club, if you will, as you know, George Carlin put it.
And I ain't in it.
And giving us the illusion. What's that?
I said it's
what's
a big
that,
club and
freedom?
I ain't
didn't
in
hear it.
It.
Oh, yes, yeah.
It's a
but,
big
you know,
club,
I mean,
and
it's,
I ain't in it.
That's right.
You
ain't
in
it. Neither am I.
We ain't in it.
So
Stevie,
it's
what
that
I could
illusion
do,
of choice.
Yes. Well, I can hang up and listen, but one thing on the Pentagon is there really was a paucity of information coming out of Washington, pictures, just hardly any material in reportage that day, and everything was focused on Manhattan, and really was for the forever. There was almost nothing to be found, and I always found that very peculiar about the Pentagon situation. But I shall hang up and listen,
of course,
because
just like
I
the 86 confiscated videos from around the Pentagon, right? There were hotels, gas stations, restaurants, everything that had video cameras of one sort at the time. 86 of them, in fact. And the
very
FBI
strange.
Came up on 9/11, confiscated them all, and we have not seen frame one from any of them in the 13 years since 9/11 happened. You know, and it's like all these questions are obviously still being asked, and it's like, well, you could dispel them very easily. Dispel them very easily. Just release the tapes, right? What kind of national security, is there national security by showing, you know, the video feed from the Gulf across the street or the Holiday Inn?
As Roger Goodell and Peter King are finding out, one little piece of video can undo a lot of your lives. And video
sure
is very powerful
right.
that way,
it
so we'll,
sure
we'll probably
right.
never see
so,
anything.
No, you're probably right, unless... Enough people keep waking up, and that's why I'm doing what I'm doing, Johnny. And because for certain it's not going to happen if we just all stay silent. That's
well,
for sure.
I, for one, Stevie,
it
am
probably
wide awake.
Won't happen if we all raise our, you know, yell at the top of our lungs either. But, you know, at least then we have a chance, and at least then we can say we've tried.
Well, you're doing God's work, Stevie. I'm going to hang up and listen to the rest of the show. Hang in there, my friend.
Freedom,
we shall talk
you calling
soon.
In, and you remember that you were You first call it to the front row at the Freak Show. We'll have a special gift for you at some time, okay?
It's an honor, Stevie.
Make sure you give Julie all your information.
Peace, my friend.
All right. Thank you, Johnny Freedom, for calling into the front row at the Freak Show. We'll just wrap up by here our last little headline. And that was some great info that Johnny Freedom had. And we appreciate his phone call into the front row. And let's just let perfect way to wrap this up. And this is the last headline that I would have liked to have seen at some point soon after 9/11/2001. And that's Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld arrested for plot to attack America. Oh, yes, indeed, I would have liked to see that. But, all right, so, hey, as, I don't even think I mentioned it in my intro or anything, but, yes, I am going to be taking on Noam Chomsky coming up in the show. But first, let's play a song, shall we? This is one that is near and dear to my heart. I think it is the most underrated country song of all time. Outlaw country, if you will. I did make a video of it on YouTube a few years back. It has since gone on to get close to 200,000 views, so I've always been pretty proud of that. It is not only one of the most underrated songs, but is probably from one of the most underrated artists in any genre, Mr. Billy Joe Shaver. And the song is called Ragged Old Truck. And, well, that's about all I'll say about it right now. So for your listening enjoyment, ladies and gentlemen, Billy Joe Shaver and Ragged Old Truck.
Early this morning, without any warning, I took me a look at myself. Good God, I seen how this marriage of life I've been living was trying to choke me to death. I laid on the bed with my gun to my head, and I nearly about ended it all. But I come to myself just before I got killed, and I blowed me some holes in the wall. I'm thinking about cranking my ragged old truck up and hauling myself into town. I'm thinking about raising the doggone to much of hell till I die for I live it all down. I lay around this place till I'm blue in the face, and I miss will be on the ground. I'm thinking about cranking my ragged old truck up and I haul it myself into town. A honky-tonk man with a honky-tonk girl on my arm. I may be as ugly as an old mud rail fence, but I'm loaded with a hillbilly charm. That's right. Yeah, it's my life, and no wife of mine's gonna tell me I can't go and have me some fun.
cranking my ragged old truck up and hauling myself into town. I'm thinking about raising the doggone too much of hell till I die for a living long time. I'm blue in the face and nightmares will be underground. I'm thinking about cranking my ragged old truck up and hauling myself into town. Yeah, I'm thinking about cranking my ragged old truck up and hauling myself into town.
Just an absolutely incredible tune. And just in case you're wondering, yeah, I did know I had my mute off at that point in the song. I just had to sing along. I laid on the bed with a kid. It nearly about ended it all. But I come to myself just before I got killed, and I blowed me some holes in the wall. Oh, dear God. Yeah, suffice it to say, I could probably spend a whole show just talking about that freaking song. I mean, seriously. So, yeah, Billy Joe Shaver, check him out. The man is still touring. Last time I saw him was, oh, man, it's almost getting to be about a year ago now, but... just released an album, and I, sad to say, I haven't, you know, given it the full attention that I probably should have at this point, but that is on my immediate things to do list. Absolute legend. As you know, we've played some Waylon Jennings here, and Billy Joe Shaver actually wrote about 80%, 8 of the 10, 7 of the 10 songs on Waylon's kind of breakout outlaw country album, Honky Tonk Heroes. And, geez, talk about, you know, spending a show on that song. I could probably have a podcast on Billy Joe Shaver, you know, every week just talking about that freaking guy's life. Holy good God. But, all right, enough of that. I am Steve Crafts, and you are listening to Front Row at the Freak Show. And once again, just to sum up, Fridays at noon, you can check me out on W4CY.com. That is W4CY.com. You can find us at frontrowatthefreakshow.com and at the Freak Show if you want to tweet us. And then Front Row at the Freak Show on Facebook and YouTube will also, I think, point you in our direction. So, hey, anyway, all right. So as our caller, Johnny Freedom, indicated, and as we put in the description of our podcast for tonight, Crafts vs. Chomsky. Yes, Crafts vs. Chomsky. All right. Here's the deal. So, I wanted to like to thank Johnny Freedom for bringing it up because I've kind of introed it now a little bit. Gnome, I probably and hopefully needs no introduction. You know, author of over 100 books, political activist, linguist extraordinaire, MIT professor, retired now, I believe. And, you know, perhaps considered one of the greatest intellectuals of the 20th century into this one, whatnot. What can you say about Noam? Right? I think I said over 100 books he's authored. So, but anyway, it's always kind of stuck in my craw a little bit with Noam's attitude and insight or his statements about 9/11. Because I expect more from Noam. And, look, I'm not going to speculate here, you know, but I don't think it's all that crazy as I was talking about with Johnny Freedom. I don't think it's all that crazy to wonder about if any pressure has been put on Noam or whatever, you know. But the statements that he's made specifically, just to me, they just don't make sense, you know. Now, I got to tell you, all right, so let me just set up what I got here for you, okay? Unfortunately, what I would have liked to have done, there's a YouTube video, or a few of them, but the one specifically that I took is about 6 minutes long of Noam, and it was uploaded in 2007 in the liner notes. It doesn't say when the discussion actually took place live, but I'm going to assume it was around that time, some, you know, between say 04 and 07, a few years after 9/11, you know. So unfortunately, I just don't know exactly when it was recorded. There's another one I thought of adding, but it you know, would have ended up being too long. What I wanted to do was just kind of upload the audio to the, you know, and then pause it and kind of rebut his marks live. But I can't do that here on BTR, unfortunately. I can only, once I start an audio here, I have to let it play through. And if I stopped it, it would then start at the beginning. So what I had to do was download the video from YouTube, upload it onto my video editing suite, splice out the audio, and then split his audio up and throw my remarks in it, okay, and then upload the whole thing. So what you're going to get is not kind of a live thing. So when I hit play here, it's going to be, how long is it? It's 14 minutes, okay? So once I hit play, again, it's just kind of, it's a thing I did tonight. So, and again, I just want to kind of point to that, you know, tonight's show and all that is a little warm-up. I'm going to have to trim this down, make it a little bit tighter, probably get it down to 7-8 minutes. But, again, I did all this. I got home at, like, 5 o'clock. I thought about the Chomsky thing while I was out working today, and I thought about the Chomsky thing. I got home and did all that and thought of my, you know, retorts to Noam. So it's a little bit of a work in progress, but, you know, what the hell isn't here on the front row, right? So without, I think that's about the only setup I got. So, you know, but anyway, again, I just want to reiterate, when you hear this, it's not me interacting live with the audio, which I wish it was. But, that being said, here is Crafts v. Chomsky. The great front row debate. So, let's go for it. Here it is.
Did the Bush administration gain from September 11th? Answer, yes. Does that tell you anything? No. Every authoritarian system in the world came from September 11th, and it was immediately predictable. I mean, I remember my first interviews with journalists a couple hours afterwards. The first question I was asked is, you know, about this, and I said, look, every power system in the world is cheering. The Russians will love it. It's giving them an excuse to increase their atrocities in Chechnya under the pretext that they're defending themselves under from terror. The Chinese will love it. They're going to step up their atrocities in Western China against the Uyghurs, claiming it's defense against terror. Indonesia loves it. They're going to go on a rampage in Aceh and massacre everyone because they have to defend themselves against terror. Ariel Sharon will, you know, go wild in the occupied territories because they have to protect themselves from terror. And so it continues. In fact, just about every country, the more violent ones just extended their own violence, but the less violent ones, say like England or the United States or France, immediately imposed what they call protection against terrorism acts of one kind or another, which had almost nothing to do with terror, but a lot to do with disciplining their own populations. So if you take a look around the world, the more, what are called the more democratic societies, instituted mechanisms of control of their population under the pretext of defending themselves against terror. So, and this was completely predictable. I mean, this happens after, even after an earthquake, things like this happen. Power systems will exploit it to expand their own power over their primary enemies, which are their domestic enemies, their own population. And if they happen to be carrying out violent repression, they'll extend it. So that the Bush administration gained from it, although true, that doesn't seem to tell you anything. It just says they're just one of the power systems in the world, so they gained from it.
All right, so, first of all, here I actually agree with Mr. Chomsky. But, you know, it also very much downplays the extent of the benefit, right? I mean, oh, they got to increase control over population, et cetera, et cetera. And yeah, we're talking about control, but also trillions of dollars in constructing and maintaining and expanding this police and spy state, or police and spy, complex, if you will. You know, and also, Noam fails to point out the actual wars in the Middle East, in Afghanistan and Iraq, as a direct result, which are more untold trillions to the military-industrial complex and the like. So, yeah, we agree, but, I think he sells it significantly short. Let's go back to now.
Did they plan it in any way or know anything about it? This seems to me extremely unlikely. I mean, for one thing, they would have had been insane to try anything like that. If they had, it's almost certain that it would have leaked. You know, it's a very poor system. Secrets are very hard to keep. So something would have leaked out, very likely. And if it had, they'd all have been before firing squads, and that'd be the end of the Republican Party forever. You know?
Okay, all right, so I guess my first question to Mr. Chomsky would be, so are you somehow suggesting that these men are sane? And if so, what is your definition of sanity? I mean, regardless of what you believe about 9/11, right? The neocon military-industrial complex globalist elite plan is wreaking havoc in the world and simultaneously destabilizing every country while they strip its natural resources, regardless of human costs or life, and leave nothing but dead or wounded or mutilated, poor, starving millions to suffer out the rest of their days in a polluted, toxic environment. I mean, does this sound like the work of sane people? They live, eat, breathe, and shit for war. So, you know, to say that they would have to be insane, well, yeah. And then the second point, it would have leaked. Why? You know? I mean, I look at something like the Manhattan Project. Years and years and years of thousands of people working on the making of the atom bomb. Never leaked. And how about Operation Northwoods, right? John F. Kennedy's Joint Chiefs of Staff and the plan that they submitted to him and worked on to try to get us to go to war with Cuba by hijacking planes and blowing them up and blaming it on Cuba. Sound familiar? To go along with setting off bombs and committing other atrocities in United States citizens and blaming it on Cuba. This was never leaked. The only reason we know about it was when it was finally declassified 40 years after they hatched the plan. So, you know, to say it would have leaked is preposterous. And certainly, since 9/11, there's been countless whistleblowers that have come out against the Bush administration. You talk about Richard Grove or Sabelle Edmonds or Kevin Ryan, or, you know, the list goes on and on and on. So, I think this is just a preposterous statement by now. There's more.
To take a chance on that, even if you could control what would, further, it was completely unpredictable what was going to happen. You couldn't predict that the plane would actually hit the World Trade Center. It happened that it did, but, you know, could easily have missed.
Gnome, you ignorant slut. All right. You couldn't predict that the planes would actually hit. All right, well, then, if that's the case, why would Osama bin Laden have tried it? I mean, shit, this plan of his had to take years to plan, cost a lot of money, and shit, you're just going to leave it to chance that the planes might hit the building, right? I mean, doesn't the same go for them that it would for anyone else, that they're taking a chance that the planes actually hit the building? I mean, I don't know. And would I be surprising you, Mr. Chomsky, by saying that drone technology has been around for 40, 50 years? You know, I think if anything, by this statement, you prove it was an inside job. I mean, you're right. It's hard enough to predict that they actually will hit their targets. So what does Osama bin Laden do? Send four guys who can barely manage to fly a single-engine Cessna plane? I mean, wouldn't you send over your top-notch commercial jet pilots? You know, ones who don't need to take lessons just the months prior to the event? Don't you think they would have thought it out a little bit better than that?
You can hardly control it, but what you could be almost certain of is that any hint of a plan would have leaked and would have just destroyed them. And to take a chance on something like that would be meaningless. Now, if you look at it, there's a big industry in the United States, on the left as well. I mean, you see the email that I get, this huge internet industry from the left, trying to demonstrate, and there's books coming out, there were bestsellers in France and so on, that this was all fake and it was planned by the Bush administration and so on. If you look at the evidence, anybody who knows anything about the sciences would instantly discount that evidence. I mean, there's plenty of coincidences and unexplained phenomena, and, you know, why did this happen and why didn't that happen and so on. But if you look at a controlled scientific experiment, same thing is true. I mean, when somebody carries out a controlled scientific experiment at the best laboratories, at the end, there are lots of things that are unexplained, and there are funny coincidences and this and that. If you want to get a sense of it, take a look at the letters columns in the technical scientific journals. You know, so like Nature or Science or something. The letters are commonly about unexplained properties of reports of technical experiments carried out under controlled conditions, which are just going to leave a lot of things unexplained. That's the way the world is. Now, when you take a natural event, you know, not something that's controlled, most of it will be unexplained. There'll be all sorts of things that happen, but you know, you can afterwards you can put them into some kind of pattern, but beforehand you can't. And the pattern may be completely meaningless because you put them in some other pattern too, if you want. I mean, that's just the way complicated events are. So the evidence that's been produced, in my opinion, is essentially worthless.
I actually have no idea what that man just said. You know, it sounded like a bunch of mumbo-jumbo gobbledygook for, I don't know what the fuck I'm talking about, but damn it, I'm Noam Chomsky, so you better listen. Fuck off, Noam. Next.
And the belief that it could have been done is so, has such low credibility.
Low credibility. Let's see, a government, a nation, a certain class, or a group of people that have on record over the last couple hundred years committed some of the most heinous crimes against humanity, that have routinely lied about their lies, and right on down the flipping line? Oh yeah, it's a stretch, no Mimi boy. What else you got?
I don't really think it's serious. I should say that, you know, I'm pretty isolated on this in the West. I mean, a large part of the left completely disagrees on this and has all kind of elaborate conspiracy theories and, you know, about how it happened and why it happened.
The left? The left has the conspiracy theories? What, you mean like Hillary and Obama and that gang? I don't know, Noam. I don't see them doing shit but supporting the official conspiracy theory. And I don't see MSNBC or any likes of the left media wing promoting the 9/11 truth movement. So, really? The left? All right, Noam, wrap this thing up, would you?
And so on, but I think they're just, first of all, I think it's completely wrong, but also I think it's diverting people away from serious issues. I mean, it just doesn't make any, I mean, even if we're true, which is extremely unlikely, who cares? You
know? Who cares? Did you say who cares? Come again? Noam? Who cares? I just finish your thought, would you?
I mean, the main significance. But it's a little bit like the huge energy that's put out on trying to figure out who killed John F. Kennedy. I mean, yeah, who knows? And who cares? I mean, plenty of people get killed all the time. Why does it matter that one of them happened to be John F. Kennedy? If there was some reason to believe that there was a high-level conspiracy, it might be interesting. But the evidence against that is just overwhelming.
Again, the apathy just overwhelming here. Who cares? Ah, Papa President. No, but the evidence against there being a high-level conspiracy to kill JFK is overwhelming? Wait, isn't the opposite true? But, all right, just finish up, would you?
And after that, it's just a matter, you know, if it happened to be a jealous husband or the mafia or someone else, what difference does it make? It's just taking energy away from serious issues aren't the ones that don't matter.
Whoa, so, okay, that was a little bit weird. That cut a little bit short. Didn't have my final retort to Mr. Chomsky, and let me go from memory here. I was just blown away by the who cares. I mean, yeah, oh, okay, Noam, I guess if, you know, the 3,000-plus people who were murdered that day, right? What do we tell to their families? Hey, the great Noam Chomsky has said, who cares? So what are you crying about, really? You know? Quit your crying already. You know? No big deal, Papa President. Whatever. You know, what I also found fascinating is that, you know, this distraction from bigger issues, right? Like, all right, well, what bigger issues are you talking about now? You know? The rise of the police and spy complex, the totalitarian governments and never-ending war. Well, seems to me all things that were increased in spades by 9/11. So, yeah, this who cares comment just it's fascinating. So, hey, anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. Like I said, that I don't know why my last little bit of dialogue got cut out there, but anyway, that was kind of it in a nutshell. And, you know, it's funny, as I was listening to it, and I know I got to trim it down in time and whatnot, but, you know, the one kind of note I was writing down here as I listened to it was when he was going on about, you know, the experiments and the evidence and that, you know, hey, if you go to any scientific lab and conduct experiments, that there's always going to be... you know, unexplained things and coincidences and these things that constantly happen, you know. And I'm just sitting there like, really? You know, like, I guess, at an initial experiment that, you know, may be the case if you're testing a hypothesis, right? But, you know, I mean, for the most part, you know, there's experiments, and certainly thousands, if not millions of them, that we can repeat without contradictions, you know, all over the place, right? I mean, steep 700 degrees. You know, you put a 100-degree fire underneath it, the shit ain't melting. Every time, all the time. And that's when things are called scientific fact. But, so I think it's weird how he says, oh, you know, this shit happens all the time in science labs across the country, you know. But, you know, also to that point is it's like, well, yeah, you know, I think that the reason why the event that there are so many just absolute absurdities, and anomalies on 9/11 is because of that, you know, chaos factor, that X factor, whatever you want to call it. You know, they controlled what they could control, and everything else, these massive questions, whether it's the 15-foot hole that was left in the Pentagon, whether it was Building 7 that collapsed at free fall speed, whether it was two planes that vaporized, whether it was only two of the eight black boxes that survived, you know, these indestructible black boxes, two on each plane, built to survive such extremes, and only two of eight of them actually survived. The fact that not one salvageable serial number part from any plane has ever been documented, recorded, reported, what have you. All these anomalies, right? So, and then all these questions that come up. If you ask questions, well, then, you know, you're just an unpatriotic scumbag. You know, what did Bush say? We will not tolerate crazy conspiracy theories. Well, how about questions? You know, you're not even going to tolerate questions. So anyway, yeah. Again, hope you enjoyed it. You know, I want to I hope you all, anyone who hears, listens to this, tunes in on Friday as well, because, you know, I'm going to be playing it again, and I'm going to do a little work on it during the week to get it a little bit more, you know, finely tuned, and I especially couldn't stand the hum that was on my audio, so I do apologize for that. But, again, I you know, obviously cannot speak for Noam Chomsky. I have no idea why a guy that has written the things he's written, said the things he said, kind of come out in with these answers. Again, and he, to me, it's like the he answers without answering, you know. Very vague. Never offers evidence either way. And there's actually, I think I alluded to before I played this, there's another video that he gets asked specifically about Building 7. And, you know, his answers, again, just really very weird, because he goes on to say, and I'll try to, you know, I'll try to make this quick, but so the way he answers is like, you know, look, you know, first of all, he admits that, you know, okay, maybe something's going on, right? And then he says, look, you know, sure, there's a couple of scientists, and perhaps they're even serious ones, that have, you know, come out and questioned this online. But, you know, what you do in the scientific community is that, you know, and it's like, stop right there, no, stop, stop. There's not just a couple of scientists, okay? Right now, Architects and Engineers for Truth stands at over 2,000 architects and engineers that have signed their petition. And if, I don't think all 2,000 have directly, you know, contributed to, you know, as far as papers and letters and all that sort of, but 2,000 have signed on, and many of them have written letters, you know, and because this is what he goes on to say. He goes on like, this is how you do it. You write your findings, and then you submit them to journals, which people have done. You know, you bring them to universities like MIT, which people have, well, actually, I shouldn't say people have, you know, they, people are trying to do this. So what do you do, Noam, when the universities and certainly some journals are not publishing your information because of what you're saying? Stephen Jones, Dr. Stephen Jones, physicist at Brigham Young University, member of both Architects and Engineers for Truth and Scholars for 9/11 Truth. Okay, he's the one that first discovered the nanothermite in the dust of Ground Zero. And, I mean, ultimately the man was, you know, kind of forced to retire from Brigham Young. And, you know, name, reputation, destroyed, and all this other stuff. So, you know, I mean, Noam sits there and pretends like, oh, this is all you have to do, you know, submit your things and this and that and yada yada. And it's like, well, that's what they're trying to do here, Noam. They're trying to raise this awareness. And if you actually look, there is a significant amount of journals that have carried their info, the ones that have had some balls. You know, so, again, just completely kind of weird ways that he approaches it and doesn't come from any factual basis. Like when to say there's one or two, you know, scientists or architects or engineers, you know, when there's over 2,000, you know, I mean, that's just really being misleading from Noam. So, again, hey, ultimately, you know, it's Noam Chomsky, you know, I mean, I bow to his brain, but what else can I say? But, you know, I guess, you know, I'm kind of at a loss for words here, as you can tell, and don't really have much else to say. So anyway, like I said, we're going to try to fine-tune that down, get the audio a little better all around, and spit that out maybe in a hopefully 10-minute version for Friday. That would be real nice. And if I can include some of the WT7, the other video that he speaks on, I'm going to try to do that as well. So, all right, so I've probably gone like that. I'm about 15 minutes over an hour, and I really kind of wanted to wrap this up. And I am going to wrap it up. What I'm going to do is I'm going to end it. I do have one more five-minute clip to pay you. As you know, I like to play a comedy spot as well here in the front row. And since it's 9/11, you know, this is certainly not a comedy piece, but it is a kind of funnier look at 9/11, I guess, if you will. It's one of the more watched videos about 9/11. It's a 9/11 conspiracy theory, or 9/11 a conspiracy theory in 5 minutes. So I'm going to end it with that, you freaks. So by tuning in to the front row at the Freak Show, Johnny, you the man. Again, I want to end the show right after this clip I have for you here. So we'll see you Friday at noon on W4CY Radio. See you at Front Row at thefreakshow.com. At the Freak Show, take a look at our tweets. Actually, if you do tweet, we're not tweeting probably even every day, but this week we are going to, and we're going to have one 9/11 link, video, tidbit, at least one every single day. Shit, can I find this here? I do want to, I got my notes from, bear with me a second, because this is kind of important. On 9/11, on Thursday, please bear with me, because I'm going to try to find this in my, slew of notes that I have here, but you can here we go. Yes, I would be remiss if I did not mention that for the anniversary of this year, a number of cities are going to be having a premiere screening of this film called The Anatomy of a Great Deception. And you can find out more by going to ae911truth.org. That's the Architects and Engineers for Truth, of course. They are also going to be doing a screening of the film as well as a whole day of stuff in New York on Thursday. So obviously, if you can make it down there, as I wish I could, certainly go check them out. But I also believe that regardless of where you live, you can catch the premiere of that on a website called nolizeradio.org. Just spelled out just like it is, nolizeradio.org. And I haven't confirmed that, but I was watching, they have a bunch of like podcasts themselves on that show, and the guy said that they're going to be doing it on that. It's a pretty good site. They have a couple of the scholars for 9/11 Truth with their podcasts and whatever, but I guess they're going to be running a screening of The Anatomy of a great Deception and like a marathon of stuff all day, different videos and all that stuff. So that's there for you to check out as well. Regardless, really, freaks, 9/11 is something that we can do something about. It really is not too big, whatever, you know. This can be the thing that brings down the whole house of cards. I truly and honestly believe that. If we can not even figure out, you know, exactly who did it or whatever, just determine as fact that it was not Osama bin Laden, it was not these 19 hijackers, and that it was rogue criminal elements within and outside of our government, that at the very, very least, at the very, very least, the actions of which over the last, you know, with the 10, 20 years preceding 9/11, by the creation of Al-Qaeda, by the, you know, by our foreign policy, by invading and destabilizing countries and arming these rogue groups, that at the very, very least, by these actions, which continue to this day, I mean, when we see now the rise of ISIS, right? Bullshit. It's bullshit. It's the same thing as Al-Qaeda pre-9/11, right? We've been arming these guys to the teeth to try to take down Assad in Syria. Arming them to the teeth. And lo and behold, you know, they take over Iraq, and now they're beheading guys and wanting to bomb America. You know? So, at the very, very least, it's coming to that realization. But really, when you dive into it, you realize that, you know, they got passports over here because of us. They were, most of them were CIA trained. And the list goes on and on. Ugly as it is. But just because it is ugly does not mean it is not true. And it does not mean that we can let the real bastards off the hook. Remember, we said, never forget, right? Well, it's tough to remember what you never learn in the first place. All right? So, all right, my fellow freaks, what happened to my screen? So, again, I'm going to leave you this 4 minute and 55 second video of 9/11. A conspiracy theory in 5 minutes. It was done by James Corbett. Please check him out at CorbettReport.com. You go there and you can check out, obviously, all his other places. I really like James. He has a really good approach and way of doing things, and his site, CorbettReport.com, is truly fantastic. It is everything that he says is backed up with documented links. And all, you can just spend days and days and days on just like one of his podcasts going to all the links that he sends you with, you know. So anyway, really good stuff. It's one of the, like I said, one of the most watched 9/11, you know, videos out there. It's got, the one on YouTube says like 2-3 million, but you know the way YouTube takes things down and requests is probably more like 10 million, to be honest with you. But anyway, 9/11, a conspiracy theory. You freaks be good. We'll see you next Monday. What's that going to be, the 17th? And until then, take care.
On the morning of September 11, 2001, 19 men armed with box cutters directed by a man on dialysis in a cave fortress halfway around the world using a satellite phone and a laptop directed the most sophisticated penetration of the most heavily defended airspace in the world, overpowering the passengers and the military combat-trained pilots on 4 commercial aircraft before flying those planes wildly off course for over an hour without being molested by a single fighter interceptor. These 19 hijackers, devout religious fundamentalists who like to drink alcohol, snort cocaine, and live with pink-haired strippers, managed to knock down 3 buildings with 2 planes in New York, while in Washington, a pilot who couldn't handle a single-engine Cessna was able to fly a 757 in an 8,000-foot descending 270-degree corkscrew turn to come exactly level with the ground, hitting the Pentagon in the budget analyst office where DOD staffers were working on the mystery of the $2.3 trillion that Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld had announced missing from the Pentagon's coffers in a press conference the day before, on September 10th. 2001. Luckily, the news anchors knew who did it within minutes.
Osama bin Laden.
The pundits knew within hours.
Osama bin Laden.
The administration knew within the day.
Terrorist who committed these acts.
and those who harbor them.
And the evidence literally fell into the FBI's lap.
That a hijacker's passport was found blocks from the World Trade Center crash site, if you can believe that.
But for some reason, a bunch of crazy conspiracy theorists demanded an investigation into the greatest attack on American soil in history. That investigation was delayed, underfunded, set up to fail, a conflict of interest, and a cover-up from start to finish. It was based on testimony extracted through torture, the records of which were destroyed. It failed to mention the existence of WTC-7, Able Danger, PTEC, Sibel Edmonds, OBL and the CIA, and the drills of hijacked aircraft being flown into buildings that were being simulated at the precise same time that those events were actually happening. It was lied to by the Pentagon, the CIA, the Bush administration, and as for Bush and Cheney, well, no one knows what they told it because they testified in secret, off the record, not under oath, and behind closed doors. It didn't bother to look at who funded the attacks because that question is ultimately of little practical significance. Still, the 9/11 Commission did brilliantly answering all of the questions the public had, except most of the victim's family members' questions, and pinned blame on all the people responsible, although no one so much as lost their job, determining the attacks were
failure of imagination.
Because
nobody in our government, at least, and I don't think the prior government that could envision flying airplanes in the buildings.
Except the Pentagon, FEMA, NORAD, and the NRO. The DIA destroyed 2.5 terabytes of data on Able Danger, but that's okay because it probably wasn't important. The SEC destroyed their records on the investigation into the insider trading before the attacks, but that's okay because destroying the records of the largest investigation in SEC history is just part of routine record keeping. NIST has classified the data that they used for their model of WTC-7's collapse, but that's okay because knowing how they made their model of the collapse would jeopardize public safety. The FBI has argued that all material related to their investigation of 9/11 should be kept secret from the public, but that's okay because the FBI probably has nothing to hide. This man never existed, nor is anything he had to say worthy of your attention, and if you say otherwise, you are a paranoid conspiracy theorist and deserve to be shunned by all of humanity. Likewise him, 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 and her. And her, and her, and him. Osama bin Laden lived in a cave fortress in the hills of Afghanistan, but somehow got away. Then he was hiding out in Tora Bora, but somehow got away. Then he lived in Abbottabad for years, taunting the most comprehensive intelligence dragnet employing the most sophisticated technology in the history of the world for a decade, releasing video after video with complete impunity and getting younger and younger as he did so, before finally being found in a daring SEAL team raid which wasn't recorded on video, in which he didn't resist or use his wife as a human shield, and in which these crack special forces operatives panicked and killed this unarmed man, supposedly the best source of intelligence about those dastardly terrorists on the entire planet. Then they dumped his body in the ocean before telling anyone about it. Then a couple dozen of that team's members died in a helicopter crash in Afghanistan. This is the story of 9/11, brought to you by the media which told you the hard truths about
his head could be seen to move violently forward.
And
they took the babies out of incubators.
And
mobile production facilities.
And
the rescue of Jessica Lynch.
If you have any questions about this story, you are a batshit, paranoid, tinfoil, dog-abusing baby hater and will be reviled by everyone. If you love your country and or freedom, happiness, rainbows, rock and roll, puppy dogs, apple pie, and your grandma, you will never ever express doubts about any part of this story to anyone. Ever. This has been a public service announcement by the friends of the FBI, CIA, NSA, DIA, SEC, MSM, White House, NIST, and the 9/11 Commission. Because ignorance is strength.